Hey, Vlad here from devinsideyou.com. Welcome to the second part in the ZIO series. Today we're going to have a proper introduction to ZIO and also start implementing our own toy version of ZIO. Let's get right to it. As in most of my videos, I'm on Windows and I'm using WSL2, which currently runs an Ubuntu 20.04 distribution inside of it. I'm also using the Windows Virtual Desktop feature, and I have key bindings that allow me to switch to Windows like this and then back to Ubuntu like that. Let's start by creating a ZIO playground right away. So I'm going to go into my dev folder, which is currently empty, and I'm going to use one of my generate templates for Scala 3. Now I'm recording this on May 17, 2021, and Scala 3 is already out, but Metals is not published yet for Scala 3. So for now, we're going to use RC3, but it's going to work exactly the same in the proper Scala 3 version. So I'm going to call it ZIO Playground, enter. I'm going to switch into that directory like this, open it with Visual Studio Code. I'm going to go straight into the build file, and I'm going to scroll down to the dependencies, and I'm going to say def ZIO, ZIO test, and the version that is currently published for RC3 is 1.0.7. All right, so I'm going to import the build, and I would like to point out that I'm also using the indentation syntax that came in with Scala 3, and I'm also using this feature flag that basically makes Scala 3 more constrained and it behaves as Scala 3.1 is going to behave. Also, I have a couple of cool flags, well, actually just one, which is this one, safe initialization, which will, it's an experimental flag, and it will try to guard and protect us against forward access reference. It's when you have a val that uses another val that is below, which is not defined yet, so you're trying to access the reference that is defined more forward. Now we're going to go ahead and start with a ZIO hello world. If you've never done any functional programming before, this might be a little bit too fast, but by the end of probably even this video, you're already going to be caught up. Let me also go and launch SBT. What we're going to do is we're going to import ZIO, and a bit later, once we're going to implement our own toy version of ZIO, we're going to simply replace this import to our own ZIO, and everything is going to work. Now in Scala 3, you can still use underscores, but in Scala 3.1, it's no longer supported, so we have to use the star or the asterisk. I'm used to saying star. Now let me also switch to running over here. Now ZIO inside of the ZIO package actually defines a trait also called app, which is why we're seeing this message object creation impossible since def run blah blah blah. If I actually see the entire message, it's going to look like this. And can I scroll in there? I can. Yeah, so basically it says that this is a different trait. Okay, so this is not the Scala app. Okay, so we're going to rewrite this hello world into a hello world for ZIO. So we're going to do override def run, and it's going to be a list of string, not an array of string. Okay, and I'm going to leave out the return type on purpose. I'm actually going to have an equal sign over here. I'm going to have these things, going to inline them like this. Okay, so this is going to be a for comprehension like this. I'm going to indent these guys to the right, and I'm going to have a yield over here. In Scala 3, we don't need the curly braces around the for. Okay, so I'm going to yield a unit. Now I'm also going to wrap this entire for comprehension, which doesn't compile yet because it's not finished. And I'm going to say dot exit code. We're going to talk about this in a second. All right. So over here, what we're going to do is I'm going to have underscore and arrow to the left like this. I'm going to copy this. I'm going to inject it over here, and I'm going to inject it over here as well. Okay. And now over here, instead of print line, we're going to use console.putString. line. The naming is coming from Haskell, actually. Okay, so this should be everything already. If I type correctly, put string line like this, and there we go. This is our hello world in ZIO. Now there are already many things happening here, so let's take it slow and let me at least try to roughly explain what is happening. It really depends on how you use ZIO, but you actually might use it for quite a while and still need only this one import, right? So just one import, and you're good to go. As already mentioned, ZIO defines the app trait, which shadows the Scala app trait. One of the key principles that went into ZIO was type inference and user friendliness, especially beginner friendliness. And so a lot of time has been invested into making it as type inference friendly as possible, which is why I omitted this return type. In fact, we're probably not going to see the return type for another two or three videos. So what we're seeing inside of these params is a program that performs a side effect. In fact, what we're going to do is I'm going to cut it out. And I'm simply going to say program over here. And I'm going to go over here. I'm going to say val program equals, and I'm going to paste this for comprehension, right? So we're going to have exactly this thing. Now, ZIO has a built-in error channel, and we're going to learn about what this means in the next video, actually. But what we need to understand that exit code is just a function, just a method defined on ZIO. And all it does, it digs into our ZIO to figure out if the error was produced. And if the error was produced, then a non-zero error code is getting returned. And if there was no error, then a zero code is being returned. We can actually switch to the scala app trait so that we don't have to deal with this dot exit code complexity. Okay, so we can just simply remove this line. And now we're going to remove this. And I'm going to indent it to the left like this. And there we go. But what you see now is that it actually doesn't run anything because it is a functional programming library. All ZIO applications are just descriptions of applications. And then you need something to evaluate this description, which is called an interpreter. And ZIO has a built-in interpreter, and it's called runtime.default. It is a lazy val that you can use all over the place because it's a lazy val. In fact, you're going to need to use this lazy val if you're introducing ZIO into an already existing code base, because usually you want to interpret your description only at the edges of your program, hopefully only at one place in the main method. But if you're introducing ZIO into an already existing code base, you might end up needing to use this all over the place. So let's put it back into a val like this, which again is not going to help. And now over here, again, one import is enough. We're simply going to say runtime.default, which is a lazy val. And now we're going to use one of the methods to interpret the program. The most popular one is unsafe run sync program like this. There we go. And we see exactly the same thing as we saw before. Since it's a lazy val, there is no harm in running it again, even though there is technically a thread pool, or technically even two thread pools behind it. Usually when you learn something like Akka, they tell you, hey, don't just go and create an actor system because behind it is a thread pool. It's a heavy thing. Over here, default is a lazy val. So it's always just one. You always have just one runtime. I should probably increase the size over here so that you see that it ran twice. Let's remove one of them. And sometimes when you integrate it into a future heavy code base, you might want to do unsafe run to future like this. Over here, it's not going to change anything because it's just going to run and finish. Okay, so it behaves exactly the same. Maybe I should leave it like this. Also, there is this weird bug in VS Code that it displays the hyphens like this. I'm actually going to go into the settings, and I'm going to find the terminal font size. I'm going to reduce it to 19 and move it back to 20, and everything is going to be fine. You know, software these days. Now, I'm not here to sell you functional programming. I already kind of assumed that you want to learn about functional programming if you're here. However, I'm just going to say one thing. If you're dealing with descriptions of the programs before they ran, before they exploded, you have way more control. You have way more very interesting combinators. For example, over here, I can go to program, and I can just simply say repeat and times. And I'm going to use the number 2 over here. And now we're going to see our application that runs actually 3 times. Now, there's some rendering issue. Let's run it again. There we go. 3 times. Now, I don't know if it's a bug or a feature. I guess it depends on how you interpret the word repeat. Maybe it's like run once and then repeat 2 more times. Okay, so I'm just going to repeat 1. In fact, I'm going to remove this. Let me actually run it again. In fact, I'm going to remove this from here, and I'm actually going to say that each one of these are individual programs. So I can go over here, and I'm going to say repeat only this line twice, or again, once, depending on how you define repeating. Now let's write a slightly more involved program. We're going to say, what is your name? A classical example. And we're going to retrieve the name from console.get string line. There's no need for params, right? Because this is not a side affecting operation. This is a description of a side affecting operation. Okay, so we're just going to have this. And now we're also going to rip out a unit out of console.put string line. And over here, we can use hello $name, the variable that was introduced over here. Okay, classic program. What is your name? My name is Vlad. There we go. Hello, Vlad. Now, since I want things to go a little bit faster, I'm actually going to remove this, and I'm going to replace it with ZIO.succeed, and I'm simply going to put Vlad in here. Okay, so it's just going to run on its own. Now, check this out. We're also going to have a little bit of fun. Not too much, just a little. We're going to have a thing called trace, which is going to be just a string. Okay, it's going to be a string interpolation over here. So we're going to have parens like this, right? The rectangular brackets. Okay, and inside of it, we're going to use ANSI codes. So we're going to use console.blue built into Scala. Okay, so this is the Scala console. Okay, then we're going to have the word trace, right? And then we're going to have another ANSI code to reset the color, okay? Like this. This is just a regular string, nothing fancy. Well, I mean, there are colors. And what I can do now is I can sort of debug each of these tiny programs, right? So again, like every line over here is a program in its own right. So I can go over here and over here and over here, and I can call a method. It's just a simple method called debug, and it wants a prefix that is going to be traced, that string that we defined over there. And this is what we're going to see. The result of this program was unit. The result of this program was Vlad. And the result of this program was union again. How cool. Now, ZIO is still a very young library. In fact, when I was playing around with this, I actually discovered a tiny little bug. So if we go over here, for example, right, and we're going to say repeat n once, then it works. But when I was playing around with it, it was actually hanging. Let me actually take this one and put it over here. Still works. I swear to God, when I was playing around with this, it was actually hanging. Let's see what happens if I remove these two. I really want to reproduce this. Maybe when I was playing around with this, I was actually using the proper console.get string line like this. Let's see. My name is Vlad. No, still fine. Interesting. Let's move this guy here. Vlad. No, still fine. I have no idea. Literally, just yesterday, it didn't want to finish. In any case, enough fun. Let's remove this. Let's remove the trace that we have just this program. And also, yes, Vlad. And I'm also going to go back and I'm going to, well, no, actually, I'm actually going to leave this thing. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go and see how console is defined. It's just a couple of helper methods that run ZIO.succeed for you. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to have over here object. And we're going to call it, I don't know, our console. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to do def put string line. Right, and again, I'm going to omit the return types, okay? And I'm simply going to say ZIO.succeed while print line the line, okay? And another one is going to be def, well, actually, it can be a val, get string line like this. And we're going to do ZIO.succeed, and it's going to be scala.io standard in read line, and this is a side effect operation like this, okay? So now I can copy our console and I can mark these consoles. And I can paste, and it's going to work exactly like it worked before. Vlad, still Vlad, it's all good. This is also one of the reasons why I mentioned in the previous video that ZIO is a batteries included functional programming library. Even though it's just a small thing like console, it's actually, it makes a lot of difference for beginners. Let me actually switch back to ZIO.succeed over here. All right. Like this, so that it runs faster. Okay, so let's say that we want it to fail before this line gets printed out. And in ZIO, you can fail with anything you want. For example, we're going to fail also with a string. I'm going to say boom, like this. And it doesn't compile while line 27. Oh, we should still, yeah, so future is a bit more constrained. So we should do unsave run sync, and that should be fine. Yeah, so we're failing with a string over here, which is why we don't see the last line of hyphens. Now, unfortunately, you can actually throw an exception over here, and it's still going to fail, and you know it's going to be caught, but it doesn't fail as it should fail, okay? So if we throw an exception over here, right, sys error actually throws an exception. We're going to call it boom. Then it's going to explode, but it doesn't explode in a proper way. It's kind of hard to see. When we're going to build our own like toy version, you're going to see that it explodes in a very weird place where it's not, where it shouldn't explode. Okay. Now, if you actually want to throw things, you would use another one called effect. Right, like this one. Like this one explodes properly. As you can see, now it's, you know, now it's handled properly. It's been caught like somewhere inside. Okay, you know, inside of effect, there's a try catch. But effectively, you have succeed and fail when you're dealing with regular values. However, if you're using exceptions, then use effect. And by the way, in Scala 3, in many cases, you don't need to say new when you're creating things. So over here, we could throw a runtime exception. Like this, boom, and we don't have to do new, right? You can also still write it, right? Throw new, right? But in many cases, you can omit the new. Now, one of the things to notice is that for most of these things to work, you would actually need to delay code like this, right? Because Scala is an eagerly evaluating language, meaning that this exception is going to be thrown long before it arrives inside of the effect function. And so if we were to look at the definition of effect, we would see that the A is a by name parameter over here, right? And in fact, ZIO actually uses by name parameters more often than something like Katz effect. For example, if you're coming from the standard, you know, category theory perspective, then you have pure defined on the monad, which is just a constructor that constructs your monad, and its parameter is not by name. And so in libraries like Katz effect, you're going to have a different factory defined on IO, which is usually called delay, that would have the by name parameter. In ZIO, you don't have that. Even succeed has a by name parameter. So in fact, we should go over here, and because this is a by name parameter, we should also delay this line as well, you know, to be 100%, you know, the same as ZIO. Okay, let me show you this. Succeed, there we go. In fact, there are many factories inside of ZIO, and this is one of those things that is going to be improved in ZIO 2 because there's just too many of them. For example, there is succeed and there is effect total, and it turns out that succeed, it just calls effect total over there, right? So one of them is going to go bye-bye. Let's go back. All right, so enough playing around. Let's actually go and create our own toy version of ZIO. And for this, we're going to, let's remove this exception first, right? So let's just do this so that we have a simpler program. And yeah, this is enough for now. So let's actually go, and I'm going to simply create a new file over here, and I'm going to call it our ZIO. Okay, and it's going to be just a file scala, the scala, and we're going to have object our ZIO. If you have seen my previous video, then you know that I like to structure my packages like this, and I call them namespaces the same way as they're called in C#. So let's go and actually grab our console. We're going to cut it out, and we're going to use the regular console instead over here. I'm pretty sure that I can save the file because I did not save the other one. So everything works fine like this. So we're going to go over here. We're going to paste it in. And, you know, for now, it's not going to work because we don't have ZIO succeed, right? So we're not going to do like import ZIO, right? If I save the file, it's going to say not found ZIO. Okay, so let's actually rename it to console, because this is how it's going to be called a bit later. And let's comment it out like this. Maybe for now also, let's remove the colon so that everybody's happy. There we go. Let's also create more space. Also, I really wanted to show you this this flag, right? This safe init flag. So if we go to main and we actually take this line, and actually I think with the indentation based syntax, I actually can bubble lines without VS Code messing up my code. Let's see. Yeah, it actually worked. Okay, so this would actually fail at runtime in Scala 2 and also in Scala 3 unless you use this flag. Look at this. It says, I'm actually going to click on this arrow over here. It says promoting the value to fully initialized is unsafe, and it gives me a call trace, right? It says, hey, like you're calling it like on line 7 over here, the unsafe promotion may cause the following problems: access not initialized value program calling trace. Okay, now I kind of like to read my code top to bottom, therefore I'm simply going to make this lazy val. Okay, and everybody's going to be happy except for metals. Let's close it. Let's reopen the file. I have no idea why Metals does this. It doesn't always clean these diagnostics. So I'm going to reload VS Code real quick. And because of this, I'm going to have to go to the settings again and to fix these hyphens, because every time VS Code reloads, these hyphens don't look good anymore. So I'm going to settings, and I'm going to go to, where is it? I'm blind. Terminal. There we go. I'm going to set it to 19 and then back to 20. There we go. Close it. All right. So the goal is to have, by the end of this video, having this program run, like this whole thing, to compile exactly like it does without importing ZIO. Instead, we're going to import our ZIO. Okay. So let's go and start. Now, as already mentioned, we need thunks, and a thunk is just a function that doesn't have any parameters, and it produces some value, right? Usually if you're dealing with a lot of parametric types, you just start calling them with the first letter of the alphabet, and then you have A, B, A, C, D, and whatever. Sometimes you have A1, A2, depending on what you're doing. Now, usually there would also be a plus over here, but we're going to have the entire, like pretty much the majority of the next video dedicated to variants. Variants plays a very large role in ZIO. For now, we're going to leave it out. We're simply going to have thunks like this. As already mentioned, it's sort of like a convention. It's way more convenient to put this thunk inside of some data structure. In Scala, this would be a case class. Now, in Scala 3, the classes are final by default. However, you can still extend them if you're in the same compilation unit. The same compilation unit usually means in the same file. So I still prefer to write final when I'm creating my case classes. Okay, IO of A, and it's simply going to contain the thunk. like this. Now, I already know where this code is going, and I know that we're going to pretty much have this type only once, so we actually don't need it. So I'm actually going to throw it out. I'm going to inline it over here, and I'm going to throw this out. Okay, so we have IO, which is just a wrapper around a thunk, nothing fancy. In fact, I almost forgot that we're actually creating ZIO and not just IO, so we're going to call it ZIO. And let's actually go and have a companion object like this. Let's have an empty line over here, and we're going to have this helper called succeed, right? It's going to have some parameter A. It's going to have the A by name parameter, very important, okay? And it's going to produce a ZIO of A, and it's going to be ZIO of, and then we just need to produce a thunk because this is a by name parameter. It's very easy to do. Just create a function that is going to return the A. And there we go. This is how succeed looks like in the ZIO library as well. There are a couple of more type parameters, but we're going to get there. It's almost too easy, isn't it? And now we pretty much have the console. It's just going to work because we have succeed, right? If we indent it properly, this is one of these Scala 3 things. Now we can already write programs with this thing, but we don't have any way to connect them or to chain them. And for this, we need a monad. Now, traditionally in functional programming, you would define monads outside of IO, right? And the way to say this would be IO has a monad, right? But ZIO didn't go this route, and Scala is an object-oriented language. So all we need to do is we need to define flatmap inside of this case class. Okay, so let's go over here. And we're simply going to define flatmap. Now, usually I would even make it final just to make it more readable, to make it more readable that, you know, we're not going to extend and change it. But since this is a ZIO series and ZIO has a sort of like a coding guidelines, and they basically say that if your class is final, then you don't need to have this keyword in all the methods. Okay, this is going to be flatmap. Okay, and it's going to have a function that is going to go from A to ZIO of B. Okay, it's a function that goes from A to ZIO of B, right? And given all of these things, we can produce a ZIO of B like this. And it's very simple to do. We just need to not forget to wrap the entire thing into succeed because we need to delay everything, right? And succeed has a by name parameter. That's exactly what we need. So essentially all we have is a thunk and this function. So we need to play around with them so that we eventually produce a B somehow inside of this scope. And then it's going to be a ZIO of B. So first we're going to call the thunk, and therefore we're going to retrieve the A from it. Okay, then we're going to call AZB with the A, and this is how we're going to retrieve a ZIO of B, like this. Okay, now we're going to retrieve the B by running the thunk on the ZIO of B, and there we go, we're done. We're going to return the B. This is the entire flatmap. This is how flatmap looks pretty much in every other IO monad. It's always the same. Now we're actually ready to write full-blown programs. We have everything that we need, but if we wanted to use for comprehension in Scala, unfortunately they always end up with a somewhat unnecessary map if you use the yield keyword. So we need to go ahead and define map, which is a simpler version of flatmap. In fact, we can pretty much copy paste this entire thing, go over here, paste it over here. Okay, so it's going to be called, let me actually have more space. And we can also and ZIO over here. I believe it's over here, right? We can and ZIO so that it's a little bit more readable. You can and scopes in Scala like this in Scala 3, okay? It's going to be a map, and the difference is going to be that it's simply going to produce a B over here instead of ZIO of B. The rest is going to stay the same. Therefore, this is just a function that goes straight from A to B. Okay, so we're going to call it over here, A to B, and therefore we're going to get out the B right away. So we don't need to call the thunk again, right? This is it. This is the entire map, unless I made a typo somewhere, but it doesn't look like it. Now, one last thing that is remaining is the runtime. So we have the case class, we have the companion object, we have the console, and now we're going to go over here and we're going to, come on, oh, seriously, VS Code? Why are you doing this to me? So we're going to go over here and we're going to have a runtime, and we're going to have object default, and we're going to have def unsafe run sync. It's going to have some A because it's going to produce some A. We're also going to delay the ZIO that comes in, and it's simply going to collapse it. Right. If you're familiar with recursion schemes or category theory, this is what is known as a catamorphism. You have some structure, usually some ADT, and you collapse it down to a single value. You can sometimes also map this value to a B instead of the A. Okay. Now, the interpreter over here is simply going to run the thunk like this. Now, this interpreter is very, very simple, and it's very simple for two reasons. One is that we're not dealing with concurrency over here, and the real ZIO does. And the second one is that we went with a much more more simpler encoding for educational reasons. The real ZIO actually uses the so-called initial embedding or initial encoding. Essentially, ZIO itself is not a case class, it's an ADT, and every method that we have over here, like flatmap or map or succeed, are actually case classes, right? So they're part of this ADT. And so the interpreter, when it comes to the interpreter, it actually has a gigantic pattern match where it says, okay, well, are we flat mapping? Now let's do this. Are we mapping? Now let's do this. Let me show this to you, actually. So if we go over here, then we can jump into something like succeed. I'm sorry, not succeed. We need to jump into the interpreter. This is actually one of the things that are kind of hard to get around, get your hand around with this. Like, let's say you wanted to see how succeed works. You jump in there and you see, well, okay, calls effect total. And then you jump in there and then you see, come on. And then you see that it just constructs some case class. Right, you can keep jumping in there, but trust me, there's not going to be anything fancy in there. See, it's just a class. So let's actually close this. Let's close the build as well. So let's jump into unsafe run sync. Okay, let's see what it does. Some stuff, and then it calls unsafe run with. Okay, let's jump in there. Okay, this looks kind of scary. Let's scroll down. Let's see what it does. It's probably evaluate now. Yeah, it's probably evaluate now. Let's jump in there. Okay, a big try catch. Yeah, that smells more like it. There is some stack. There is some stuff. There is while. There is if else's and a bunch of stuff. And there we go. There we go. This is the pattern match. It says, hey, if it's a flat map, then let's do flat map. If it succeeds, let's do this. If it's effect total, let's do this. Now, I didn't want to go this route since I wouldn't be able to resist talking about continuations and structural recursion and probably even recursion schemes. So this was, you know, this would be completely unnecessary. Now, again, this is one of those things that makes ZIO a little bit harder to understand if you want to jump in there, you know, maybe if you want to contribute to ZIO or something, right? But usually as a user, this is not what you need to be concerned about. And it's, in fact, it's actually done for a reason. Because you have this interpreter and ZIO can inspect the structure of your program, it can optimize it, it can rearrange things. For example, it can reassociate all your left-leaning flat maps to the right so that it becomes stack safe. And if you have no idea what I just said, then don't worry about it because ZIO is going to take care of it. In fact, any other decent monad in any other monad library, that provides ZIO monad is going to take care of it. It's going to, you know, triplet it properly and it's going to make it type safe. So you just don't need to worry about any of this. And also what we have done is actually already enough. We can actually go back to our main and we can look at our console and we can simply say our ZIO, and unless I've forgotten something, it's still going to work exactly the same. Look, this entire thing is already working. In fact, we can switch back to doing console dot get string line. There we go. What's your name? Let's do something else so that we see that it's actually working. Hello, something else. And most importantly, same as before, because we delayed everything properly, right? Remember, succeed had a by name parameter and everything is like delayed properly. Then if we comment out in these two lines, scala FMT should indent this properly for me. Nothing is getting executed, right? So even if you had the, the fail function, it wouldn't run. It wouldn't explode, right? So we did good. Let's do this. There we go. It's flat, and let's switch back to ZIO succeed. Succeed, flat, right? Our import, this is not the real ZIO. Now, this is not the full picture, of course. We can't even fail. So in the next video, we're going to continue to build out our own version of Toy ZIO. For now, as always, it's been Vlad from devinsideyou.com. Don't forget to like this video if you did, subscribe if you want to improve the developer inside you. And if you learned something today, please consider supporting me on GitHub sponsors or Patreon, whatever you prefer. And also watch my videos weeks and sometimes even months before everyone else. And most importantly, take care.